good to see everybody here today in the service, and we've got Sarah Kate here this morning. It's following the Lord Believer's baptism. Sarah, have you repented of your sin and by faith put your trust in Christ as your Savior? Sarah Kate, based on your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Buried in his likeness, raised to walk in the name of the Lord. Amen. Good to see you today. We always begin our service focusing on a passage of Scripture and a time of prayer. James 4, 8 through 10. Draw near to God, and he'll draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Amen. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and you pray and seek the Lord and confess your sins and prepare your heart for worship today. So let us pray.
Good morning. Would you stand as we sing? Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I say. You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun is. this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. The Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing. All that you've done for me.
Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to welcome you to Pleasant Valley this morning. If you are a guest, please take a moment to fill out the card that is in the back of the pew or use the QR code in the bulletin to let us know that you were here today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for all that you do for us. We love you. We thank you for the amazing grace that you give to us where you died for us. When we call on you, that you save our souls. Lord, we just pray that you will be with the remainder of our service. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Would you stand again as we sing? Open the eyes of my heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see.
Pour out your power and love as we sing.
Trust the heart of your Father when the answer goes beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, lift your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. And when you don't understand the purpose of his plan, in the presence of the King, bow the knee, trust the heart of your Father when the answer goes beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, lift your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. And when you don't understand the purpose of his plan, in the presence of the King, bow the knee.
You may be seated as we continue to sing.
In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. Took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay. Light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ.
hear me? Is this known? Of all people I want to know. That's your son-in-law. Think about the words you just sung. In the power of Christ, I'll stand. Think about that. You know, what are we here for? What we're created to do? It says, let everything that has breath praise you, the Lord. That's what we're created for, folks. To praise our Creator. And everything we do, every fiber of our being, every breath we breathe, should be something that praises our Creator, our God. Take away the melodies, take away the songs I sing, take away all the lines, all the songs you let me write. Does the man I am today say the words I need to say? Let them see me, you in me. Let them hear you when I speak. Let them feel you when I sing. Let them see you. Let them see you in me. Who am I without your grace? Another smile, another face, another breath, a grain of sand, passing quickly through your hand. I give my life an offering. Take it all, take everything. Let them see you in me. Let them hear you when I speak. Let them feel you when I sing. Let them see you. Let them see you in me. With every breath I breathe, I sing only a melody, but I pray they hear more than a song in me, Let them see you in me. Let them hear you when I speak. Let them feel you when I sing. Let them see you. Oh, let them see you in me. Let them hear you when I speak. Let them feel you when I sing. Let them see you. Let them see you in me. Let them see you in me. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abides in the vine, no more can you than ye, except ye abide in me. I am the branch vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing.
you have a copy of God's Word, if you'd turn to Luke, Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, we're going to read verse 45 through 48. If you'd stand in reverence and honor of God's Word, Luke chapter 24, beginning with verse 45. And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the Scriptures. Then he said to them, "Thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things." May God bless the reading of his word. You may be seated.
Thank you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do truly thank you, Lord, for just who you are, allowing us to be here this morning to take up this offering, Lord, and just to give back to you a portion of what you've given us. And Lord, we're so thankful that you've blessed us, Lord, beyond what we can understand sometimes. But we pray that we'll be able to take it and to use it here, Lord, to upbuild thy kingdom in a way that'd be pleasing to you, Lord. And we just again thank you for who you are. Thank you for this service coming up, for Brother David bringing the message, Lord. And we pray that you help us to, and it's the message that just what we need to hear. Lord, we just thank you for that and ask you now to go with us, lead us and guide us as only you can. For it's in Christ's precious name we pray. Amen.
This morning, I want to begin by sharing about conviction of sin. We're going to talk about conviction of sin and then the glory of the cross. And the Bible tells us very clearly in the New Testament that one of the roles of the Holy Spirit is to convict the world of sin. In John 16, verse 8, Jesus tells us that. And the word convict is a word which means to convince someone of the truth. To reprove, to accuse, to refute, to cross-examine a witness. That's what convict means, convince. And the Holy Spirit acts as a prosecuting attorney who exposes evil and reproves evildoers. And the role of the Holy Spirit convinces people and convicts people of their need of a Savior. So to be convicted is to feel the terribleness of sin. And this happens when we see the beauty of God, we see His purity, we see His holiness, and we recognize that sin cannot dwell with God. When Isaiah stood in the presence of God, In Isaiah chapter 6, he immediately was overwhelmed by his sinfulness. What did he say? You remember, he said, "Woe is me. I am ruined. I'm a dead man. I'm not going to survive this because I'm a man of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord God Almighty." That's Isaiah chapter 6, verse 5. And so to be convicted is to experience an utter dreadfulness of sin. We're convicted when we become mindful of how much our sin dishonors God. We are convicted when we become intensely aware of the wrath of God and how our souls are exposed to that wrath. And so we praise the Lord for the conviction of sin. If you're here today and you're saved and you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you understand conviction of sin. You know what that means. Why? Because there's no salvation apart from conviction of sin. No one is saved apart from the Spirit convicting and the regenerating work of the Holy Spirit in our heart. Now I want you to think, because if man was left in conviction of his sin, that would be terrible. Literally, that would be hell on earth. I mean, for you to be convicted of sin, to feel the guilt of your sin, the terror of your sin, the dread of your sin, and then to be left in that. Because you see, terror and dread does not produce repentance. It drives us to where the hope is. And so sight and sense of sin alone will not bring salvation and true repentance. You see, any true repentance will only ever be born in our lives when we come to see Christ crucified for sinners, and that He freely receives and welcomes sinners. And so a sight of God's great mercy in Christ fuels saving repentance. Richard Sibbes so eloquently put it this way. He said that there is more mercy in Christ than sin in us. Without this, anything that goes by the name repentance is nothing more than just a legal attempt at moral reformation. And there's a lot of people who think that's what repentance is. It's just kind of moral change and kind of changing the way you're living your life, but that falls short of the saving grace of God in Christ. We must have a laying hold of God's mercy in Christ. I must have a saving sight of the cross of Jesus Christ and God's mercy displayed in Jesus. Now, in this text that I read this morning, we have a post-resurrection appearance of Christ. He's been risen from the dead. He appears to these two guys on this Emmaus road, and they're traveling along, and they're kind of downhearted. They're kind of discouraged about all that has transpired, and Jesus begins to talk to them and carry on a conversation, and He begins to open up their understanding that they might comprehend the Scriptures, the Bible says. And in verse 47, He said, "And that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in His name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, and you are witnesses of these things." You see that little phrase, "these things"? You say, what is these things? Well, the mediatorial work of Christ. I thought about an illustration. That's exactly what Paul does when he's before King Agrippa. He's before the king, and he gives his testimony. And I want you to look at it, Acts 26, verse 19 through 26. Notice what Paul says to Agrippa. He said, "Therefore, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first to those in Damascus and in Jerusalem and throughout all the region of Judea and then to the Gentiles that they should repent, turn to God, and do works befitting repentance. For this reason, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. Therefore, I have obtained help from God. To this day I stand, witnessing both the small and great, saying no other thing than those which the prophets and Moses said would come." And here it is.
that Christ would suffer, that he would be the first to rise from the dead and would proclaim light to the Jewish people and to the Gentiles. You say, well, what's Paul doing there? He's proclaiming the gospel, and he's telling Agrippa about repentance and about conviction of sin. Now, by nature, as human beings, we would construct many ways to God until we are driven back with the conviction of our sin. There is one way to bridge the gap between holy God and sinful man. One way, and that is Christ crucified. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 and 6, there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. You see, the God who commands men to repent has provided a way through Christ crucified. Deuteronomy 32, verse 39, the Bible says, now see that I, even I, am he, and there is no God beside me. I kill and make alive. I wound and I heal, nor is there any who can deliver from my hand. So what that verse is saying is, God is the one who wounds and kills. He's the one who heals and makes alive. The God who wounds is the God who heals. And he shows us our great sin. He shows us. We are convicted. We see it. We feel it. We know it. And then he provides a great sacrifice in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're driven to that cross. We're driven to see the glories of the cross. 2 Corinthians 4, 6. For it is God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Zechariah 12, verse 10. And I will pour out on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication. They will look on me whom they pierced. Yes, they will mourn for him as one who mourns for his only son and grieves for him as one grieves for a firstborn. And so as we look to Christ, the one who was pierced for our transgression, when you really look at the cross, you begin to see the full measure of your sin. You begin to see your sin and what it really is when you really look at the cross. And so I just got 3 points today. So what we're talking about is the conviction of sin and the glories of the cross. Notice number one. In the cross, you see an accurate view of sin. In the cross, you see an accurate view of sin. The cross of Christ tells us that sin is a curse. When used as jewelry around the neck, a cross says little about the ugliness of sin. A wooden cross hanging, you look at that and you think, how beautiful, but that says nothing of how terrible our sin is. But when we look at sin through the cross of Christ, we see sin as God sees sin. Sin is ugly. It's deforming. It's condemning. Your sin separates you from your Creator. It's condemning. Sin, you know how terrible sin is? Sin is so terrible that it made God send his only begotten Son into this world to a cross to die a horrid death for you and me. That's how bad sin is. Las Vegas is Sin City, they say. It doesn't present a true picture of sin. In the nightclubs and on the TV, we look at it, and what do we see? Well, sin is glamorized, it's gaudy, it's fun, it's exhilarating. But listen to me today, sin causes death, death and separation from God. Romans 6, 23, the wages of sin is what? That's the payment for sin. Isaiah 59, Verse 1 and 2. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, nor is his ear heavy that it cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. You see, Jesus became a curse for us hanging on that cross. Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on the tree. I should see this when I see the cross. Christ was the curse bearer. He was bearing my curse and your curse. And God spared not his own son, Romans 4:25, who was delivered up because of our offense. You see that? Not on his own. He knew no sin. He was delivered up because of our offense and was raised because of our justification. Romans 8:32. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all. 1 Peter 2:24. Who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sin, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. 1 Peter 3:18. For Christ also suffered once for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. Isaiah 53, verse 5 and 6. But he was wounded for our transgressions. Our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The holiness of God shows the revulsion that God has towards sin. God hates sin, toward our sin, and yet, despising sin, a holy God must. And the Lord Jesus took all the sins of the world upon himself as he went to Calvary. Can you even fathom that? I mean, every human being that ever lived that was going to come to faith and trust in Jesus Christ bore those sins on that cross. Jesus was not only agonizing over the wrath of the Father, he was agonizing over the sin he would bear on our behalf. And I just say today, what a wonderful Savior. Romans 5:8. But God demonstrated his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Do you tire of hearing about the cross? I don't. I don't tire of preaching about it, and I preached about it here a lot. I read a story about during the American Civil War, a farmer in New York was drafted for the Union Army, and this man's wife had died, and he was the sole supporter, and he had several small children, and he was drafted to go to war, and there was an unmarried man in the town who had no dependents, and he came to his home, and he said, look, I know you've got young children, and your wife has died, and so I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to war in your place. And for the sake of his children, the farmer accepted the offer. And so the generous friend marched off to battle. In the very first engagement that he was involved in, he was shot and killed. When the farmer heard what had happened, he went to the scene of the battle. He got the body. He brought it back. He buried his friend in the village churchyard. And he had these words engraved on the headstone. He died for me. He died for me. You see, the truth of the gospel is that Jesus Christ gave his life while we were yet still enemies of God. Sinners, alienated from God. He died for me. You see, think of it. Our minds can't even grasp this truth. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he, that's God, made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. Hallelujah. I mean, God did that on our behalf. And Jesus on that cross was cursed for us. Martin Luther, the great reformer, said this, quote, "Paul does not say that Christ was made a curse for himself. The accent is on the two words, for us. Christ is personally innocent. Personally, he did not deserve to be hanged for any crime of his own doing. But because Christ took the place of others who were sinners, he was hanged like any other transgressor." He goes on, Luther, "Whatever sins I, you, all of us have committed or shall commit, they are Christ's sins, as if he had committed them himself. Our sins have to be Christ's sins, or we shall perish forever." End of quote. I want to dig a little deeper in what we believe about this cross and about this atonement. And I preached this before, but I'm going to keep preaching it because we need to be reminded of it. As Baptists, we believe in a vicarious penal atonement. A vicarious penal atonement. I think so many times when we think about the cross, we're like, yeah, Jesus died on the cross, and yeah, but he did it because he loved us, and yeah, he died there. But listen to me. I want to break down each one of these words. Notice number one, vicarious. Vicarious. Webster defines vicarious like this: serving instead of someone or something else. The Catholics, they believe the Pope is the vicar of Christ. They believe the Pope is the representative of Jesus Christ on earth. But Jesus' death was vicarious, undergone in our place. I think a better word that we can understand is the word substitute. You see, a substitute teacher, you understand what that is. A substitute in a game, a substitute player in a sporting event. Well, Jesus was the vicarious wrath bearer, curse bearer. You see, why did the Father will the death of his only beloved Son and in so painful and shameful a form? Isaiah 53, 6, we read it a minute ago, because the Father, the Bible says, has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Laid on him. And so we say, when we say, Christ died in my place, that's what we mean by vicarious. He was my substitute. He took my place. Number two, the word penal. Penal, Jesus, by his own sacrificial choice, was punished, penalized in the place of sinners. Substitution, thus satisfying the demands of justice so God can justly forgive sin. God is not willing or able to simply forgive sin without providing satisfaction for that sin. You see, God has, he's just. He's just. Sin has to be punished. God is not willing or able to just forgive sin. He's got to have sacrifice. And it states that God gave himself in the person of his Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer the death, the punishment, and curse due to fallen humanity as the penalty for our sin. A conceptual instrument for conveying the thought that God remits our sins and accepts our persons into favor. Not because of any amends or things that we've done or we've attempted, but because the penalty which was due us was diverted to Christ. Christ bore that penalty. Listen to a quote. It says, quote, "The notion which the phrase penal substitution expresses is that Jesus Christ our Lord, moved by love that was determined to do everything necessary to save us, endured and exhausted the destructive divine judgment for which we were otherwise inescapably destined. and so won us forgiveness, adoption, and glory. It goes on. To affirm penal substitution is to say that believers are in debt to Christ specifically for this, and that this is the mainspring of all their joy, peace, and praise, both now and for eternity. All right? Penal. Then number three, atonement. Vicarious, penal, atonement. It was atoning because it secured remission of sin for us and reconciliation to God. You see, atonement means making amends. It means blotting out the offense, giving satisfaction for wrong done, thus reconciling to oneself the alienated other. It's really restoring a disrupted relationship. It was a sacrificial death, fulfilling the principle of atonement taught in connection with the Old Testament sacrifices. We read in Hebrews 9:22, Leviticus 7:11, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. And God well pleased with His Son throughout His earthly ministry. We see several times throughout Christ's earthly ministry where God said, "This is my beloved Son. I am well pleased with Him. This is my beloved Son. I love my Son." And Jesus said, "All I do for the Father, and I do what pleases the Father." But yet, what did God do? God abandoned His Son at the cross. Isaiah 53:10 says it so well. "Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise Him. He has put Him to grief. And when you make His soul an offering for sin, He shall see His seed, He shall prolong His days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in His hand." Hey, friend, if you can look at the cross under the black sky and hear the cries and see the blood and the shame there at Calvary, and that doesn't bring you to see how terrible, how awful your sin is, then I don't know what else can do it. The sin you commit, the sin you harbor, the sin you cling to, the sin you will not forsake, that sin put Christ on the cross. He bled there and died there for sin. What is my point? This first point is, in the cross you see an accurate view of sin. I think there's so many people who think, you know, well, sin, everybody sins, you know, everybody does it, and it's no big, it's kind of like it's no big deal. Oh, it's a big deal. You want to know how big a deal was? You want to know how big a deal sin is? Look at that bloody cross, the sinless Son of God hanging there. That's how bad it is. Notice number two. In the cross, we see how God's righteousness can be fulfilled. Here's the question. How can God be just and be a justifier? Now, I'm going to quote a lot of passages here, so hold on. Romans 3:26, "To demonstrate at the present time His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus." Notice there on your outline, the New Testament references to the blood of Christ are regularly sacrificial. Let's prove it. Romans 3:25, "Whom God set forth as a propitiation by His blood through faith to demonstrate His righteousness, because in His forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed." Romans 5:9, "Much more then, having now been justified by His blood, we shall be saved from wrath through Him." Ephesians 1:7, "In Him we have redemption through His" what? "Blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of His grace." Revelation 1:5, "And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to Him who loved us and washed us from our sins in His own blood." And then notice B, Jesus was a perfect sacrifice for sin. He was a perfect sacrifice for sin. Romans 8:3, "For what the law could not do, and that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, on account of sin, He condemned sin in the flesh." Ephesians 5:2, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. 1 Peter 1:18 and 19, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by the traditions from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. You see, Jesus was the perfect sacrifice for sin. And then notice, see, Christ's death was our redemption. It was our redemption. It was our rescue by ransom. The paying of a price that freed us from the jeopardy of guilt, our enslavement to sin, our expectation of the wrath of God. Romans 3:24, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Galatians 4:4-5, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, do what? To what? To redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. Colossians 1:14, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin. Notice D, Christ's death was God's act of reconciling us to himself, overcoming his own hostility to us that our sins provoked. Let's prove that statement. Romans 5:10, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. 2 Corinthians 5:18-19. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Colossians 1:20-22. And by him to reconcile all things in himself, by him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross. And you, who once were alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he has been reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy, blameless, and above reproach in his sight. Hallelujah. Notice E, the cross propitiated God's wrath, quenched his wrath against us, extinguished our sins and removed them from our sight. Romans 3:25, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood. Hebrews 2:17, therefore in all things he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. 1 John 2:2, and he himself is a propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the whole world. 1 John 4:10, and this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. You see, the cross had this effect because in his suffering, Christ assumed our identity, as it were, and endured the retribution, the judgment due us, the curse of the law. We're guilty. We're sinners. But as our substitute and in our place, with the damning record of our transgressions, nailed by God to his cross as the tally of crimes for which he was now dying. It was like he took your sins and my sins and all the sins of those who would believe, and he nailed them on that cross there with Christ as he bled, as he suffered, as he died, and he bore the wrath of those sins, the wrath of God. Colossians 2:14, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Luke 22:37, for I say to you, that this which is written must still be accomplished in me. And he was numbered with the transgressors, for the things concerning me have come to an end. You see, God is just, God is holy, and I'm a sinner. And in the cross, God demands is fulfilled, the broken law and sin. You see, the measure of God's holy love for us is this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. Romans 5:8, Romans 8:32. Evidently, there was no alternative to pay that price if we were to be saved. So the Son, at the Father's request, through the eternal Spirit, you know what he did? He paid it all. He paid it all on that cross. You see, God set aside the record of debt that stood against us and nailed it to that cross. Hallelujah. Had we been among the watchers at Calvary, we should have seen nailed to the cross Pilate's notice of Jesus' alleged crimes. But if by faith we look back to Calvary from where we are now, what we see is a list of our own unpaid debts of obedience to God, and for which Christ paid the penalty in our place. If you'll just look back to the cross today, you'll see your sins, all of them, nailed on that cross. Paul learned that himself, and that's why he could testify in Galatians 2:20. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul knew that his sins were on that cross. P.P. Bliss, his simple words, we sing it, says it all. Bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what a Savior. In the cross, you see an accurate view of sin. In the cross, we see how God's righteousness can be fulfilled. But lastly, number three, in the cross, God displays his mercy, grace, and love. You see, but against this backdrop of human hopelessness, we have conviction of sin, and we see how desperate we need and how we've sinned against a holy God, and we've got this guilt and we've got this shame and we've got this burden weighing us down, and we cry out, what are we to do? What are we to do? Well, you look to God and you see how the Scripture sets forth the love, the grace, the mercy, the pity, the kindness, the compassion of God, the offended Creator in Himself providing the atonement that our sins had made necessary. And when you look at that cross and you see Christ and you understand what is transpiring there, oh, what love, oh, what mercy, oh, what kindness. This amazing grace is the focal center of the New Testament, of our faith, of our hope, of our worship, of our ethics, of our spiritual life. From Matthew all the way to Revelation, it shines out with breathtaking glory. John 3:16 says it well, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. When a man is convicted of sin, he comes to the mercies of God. Isaiah 55, verse 1 through 7, ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Yes, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you. The sure mercies of David, indeed I have given him as a witness to the people, a leader and a commander for the people. Surely you shall call a nation you do not know, and a nation who do not know shall run to you because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Now listen to what he says. God's speaking to somebody today. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. I couldn't help but think when I was preparing this message about, in Luke 15, the story Jesus told of the prodigal son. I want you to think about and listen to how Jesus speaks of the love and the grace and the mercy of the Father. You know that parable is about the Father. It's what it's about. It's about the Father. It's not about the prodigal. It's about the Father, His mercy and grace. Luke 15, the Bible says, but when he came to himself, the prodigal, he said, how many of my hired servants have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise, and I'll go to my father, and I'll say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him. He had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. You see, when the prodigal repented, when he came to himself, he knew that his father was full of love, mercy, and grace. He had no doubt that his father would receive him. Friend, I'm telling you today, if you'll come to God, if you'll come to the Lord Jesus, he will not cast you out. He is so full of love. He is so full of mercy. He is so full of grace. And when he sees you, he will have compassion on you. And he will embrace you. And he'll kiss you much. The Bible says, all the Father gives to me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. Seek the Lord while he may be found. And he'll have mercy. And he will abundantly pardon. John 3:14-15, when Jesus was talking to Nicodemus, he says, as Moses lifted up the serpent into the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. You know that story in the Old Testament. God sent fiery serpents to bite the children of Israel, and they were dying, by thousands were dying. And Moses goes and cries out to God and says, what are we going to do? And he said, I tell you what you do. You get a pole, a brazen pole, and put a picture of a serpent on it and stick it up and tell the children of Israel when they get bit to go look at that. When they look at it, they'll live. You see, that was a type, an Old Testament type of the cross. As Moses lift up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And I don't know if you've ever noticed, but on like ambulances and some medical things, you see that. You see a snake on a pole. That's where that came from. As Moses lifted up the serpent, listen, you see what God's trying to tell us today? Look to Christ and live. Live. Look to Christ and be forgiven. Look to Christ and have your guilt removed. Look to Christ and be reconciled to God. Look to Christ and go to heaven one day and not to hell. If man was left in the conviction of his sin, as I said earlier, can you imagine you being convicted of your sin, seeing the terribleness and the dreadfulness of your sin, and left in that condition? That'd be hopeless. Be hell on earth. Terror and dread does not produce repentance alone, but it drives us to where the hope is. There's hope in Christ. Have you been experiencing the conviction of sin? There might be somebody here today, and through the preaching of the word, through your Bible reading, through Sunday school, through whatever means God has used, you're convicted. You feel that guilt. I don't care. You might have been in church for a long time. You might have made a profession of faith before, but it wasn't real. It wasn't genuine. And you're sitting there, and you just, and I tell you, a lot of times, you know what people do, man? When the heat gets turned on and the conviction of sin comes, they bolt. They run. You're like, well, where'd they go? They was here, and then all of a sudden, they just left. They just left the church. What's the deal? Well, they just said it's time to move on. Christ has come as your substitute. And I just want to say today, if you'll come to the cross, come to Christ and see him, he'll save you. And I tell you what, Jesus is full of grace. He's full of love. He's full of mercy. How can he not be what he's done for us? He saved us. Turn. Turn. Turn from yourself. Turn from your sin and your guilt. And turn to the cross and turn to Christ and look upon him and live. And live. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the conviction of sin. Thank you for the glories of the cross. God, I don't know what you're wanting to do this morning. But Lord, we ought to be shouting this house down over what you have done on our behalf. You're such a wonderful God and such a wonderful Savior. Lord, you love us so much. So God, take your word and use it as you see fit in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand.